Hello everyone, Happy New Year and welcome to the very first book review on my channel in the year 2021. This review is going to be of the book, The Courage to be Disliked, written by Ichiro Kishimi and Fumitake Koga. The subtitle of the book is How to Free Yourself, Change Your Life and Achieve Real Happiness. So you might be interested in this book if you have interest in psychology, philosophy or self-help, self-development. In this video, I'm gonna do four things. I will first provide a summary of the book. What is the content? Very briefly, what we read in the book. Then I will say a few things about why I like this book, the things that I like about the book. And then I will follow that with my criticism, things that I didn't like as much. And at the end, I will make some suggestions. If you like this kind of book, if you enjoyed, have read and enjoyed, there are certain themes, topics that you can keep reading about in other books. Some of them I would consider better books than this. So let's begin with a summary. This book, The Courage to be Disliked, is a series of conversations, fictional conversations, between two people, a younger man and a relatively older philosopher. And a philosopher serves as the guide. They meet for a total of five times. Each time they meet, they pay attention to their central topic, but each conversation also goes in different directions, branching out to related topics. So the topic at the center of the book, topic at the center of the conversations is happiness. Whether happiness is possible at all, how is it possible if it is possible, whether happiness has something to do with how other people think about us, the opinion of other people about us, whether or not they recognize our worth, is that something that makes us happy? And here, of course, the clue is in the word dislike. Happiness has something to do with being free, living freely, and living freely can sometimes be indicated by the fact that some people dislike us, and that's actually a good thing. So the central topic, again, happiness, but there are other topics, side topics that branch out of that main topic. And these side topics include trauma, and here the idea is whether our past history, or the past events in our life, whether or not they determine who we are, whether or not they determine our destiny, our fate, if we had some traumas in the past, or whether we can make decisions despite our history, despite our traumas. Another side topic is human relationships. Another is human emotions, the role of human emotions in the conduct of life. Another side topic is what it means to be a mature person. What does it mean to be an individual and attend to individual tasks, the set of tasks that are introduced in this book. The idea of community is also discussed, and the importance of living in the moment versus living in the future or in the past. All right, so after that summary, let me go through what I liked, what I particularly liked about this book. The language is very clear, easy to understand, especially for readers who don't have an extensive background in psychology or philosophy. Another thing I like is that the book makes it immediately clear why this type of topic, this type of thinking can be relevant for your life, for our lives. Why it is worthwhile to read, to think, to question, to ask questions, to engage in philosophical, psychological discourse, psychological reading. So this book makes it clear why reading about psychological questions, why having conversations about psychology, philosophy is important, why those conversations can be relevant for us, actually impact our lives in positive ways. I also like the fact that, in my view, the book is written in the spirit of love, and it is apparent that the authors actually want to make a positive impact by writing this book. The author's heart, in other words, is the hearts are in the right place. Something else that I like is that the book sheds light on the role of decisions in human life. It really brings into focus the theme of decisions, making choices and decisions. It shows us that making decisions can happen unknowingly. So from very early years of our lives, we begin living and we begin making these decisions first unknowingly, without really knowing what it is that we are doing, without really knowing the concept of decision. But we do engage in decision making. We sort of make decisions sort of consciously. But the more we reflect, the more we make decisions, and the more we can step back and reflect on what we are doing, the more these decisions can become conscious decisions, the more we can realize that these are decisions. So many situations that we might think as unchangeable, so many times that we might think that we are stuck in a situation or we have a problem that cannot be solved, we can step back and realize that this situation is in part a product of our decisions. Not a decision that we have made in the past, but a decision that is ongoing, that is the decision that we continue to make, continue to affirm the decision, and actually with that decision, we create the problems that we suffer from. Moreover, the book also sheds light on the concept of courage, the role of courage in the human life. Again, so many times, the problems we have, they don't have as much to do with our abilities or our resources. Instead, it's a matter of courage. But I think this should not be generalized. I think sometimes it is true that our problems are related to our ability or our resources or our opportunities. But at least in some cases, what we lack or what we should pay attention to is a question about courage. Do I have the courage to go and do something, try to do something, to confront a truth? Something else that I like about this book is that just its format of a dialogue. Why is the format of a dialogue important? The two characters in the book, they come together, they meet, and they have a human encounter. They try to find common ground. That's extremely important that we see in the book, that they both try to understand each other. Each of the two characters tries to understand the point of view of the other person. And that practice is very instructive. If you pay attention to what they do as they are trying to understand the other side, it is quite helpful. We can model that in our own conversations. You also see the tensions and disagreements between these two guys. And you see how emotional they get sometimes. Especially one of them gets quite emotional, the young man, unsurprisingly. And the role of emotions in conversations, that when you're really invested in a dialogue, when you really are talking about something that is important to you, you can get emotional, that your emotions are actually also involved in the conversation. Disagreement is not necessarily a problem to remove. It is part of our lives to disagree, to think differently, because we each have different perspective on life. The two conversation partners in this book, they reach an agreement at the end of each of those five sessions, each of those five dialogues. But when they gain some distance, when the young man goes away for a while, lives his own life, gets back in touch with his own point of view, he gets back in touch with his disagreements with the older philosopher. So we get that they're in the long term, the differences in their point of view is actually maybe not something that would go away. All right, now things that I dislike about this book. First, I was uncomfortable by how much credit was given to Alfred Adler. Alfred Adler is presented here in this book as somebody who has got all the answers. And that is not a realistic assumption. We cannot even say that psychology as a discipline, psychology as one approach among other social sciences, that psychology has all the answers. That's not true. Let alone saying that one psychologist has all the answers. One persistent problem in psychoanalysis is that the main figures, these leaders of psychoanalysis, the relatively more well-known, famous figures in the history of psychoanalysis, they might become kind of cult figures. It happened with Freud and some Freudians, with Carl Jung, with Jacques Lacan, and now same tendency is happening with Alfred Adler. And that is an unfortunate and unproductive tendency. It might block exploring other thinkers, other ways of thinking. So again, I emphasize, this is a problem because no one thinker has all the answers. Next, the discussion is at some points quite simplistic. I appreciate the teleological analysis of emotion and trauma as a device. For instance, we get some really helpful analysis of emotions. Let me give you one example. I want to complain. I'm at a coffee shop. My coffee arrives and the coffee is cold. It's supposed to be hot. I get angry and I yell at the coffee shop staff. Just an example. I will not do that, but that's just an example. The authors consider the possibility that it's not that I get angry and then I yell, but instead, maybe I want to yell, I want to communicate the point that I have, my dissatisfaction with the coffee, and I need to be angry to communicate that. So I recruit anger, I use anger as a device in order to communicate. Similarly, it might appear that sometimes I use past events. I say, oh, I was bullied in school, in primary school, that's why I'm so shy now. That's why I'm not a social person. But actually, in reality, it is possible that I don't want to be a social person, and to justify my lack of sociability, I use my past events, I recruit my past events to rationalize. So the order of causality is something that we should be cautious about. We should be cautious interpreting what comes first. Next, in the list of my criticisms, some of the language is quite unhelpful and unclear. So in the very first dialogue, we confront the question, is the world a simple place or is the world complicated? What kind of world do we live in? Do we have a complicated world or a simple world? What the philosopher is doing here is not actually simplifying the young man's world. He is, in fact, enriching the young man's world. He's introducing him to new ways of thinking. So he's saying, actually, the ways in which you are thinking are not the only possible ways to think. There are more ways of thinking. So in other words, the world is more complicated. It's more complex than you think. You have more choices. So the distinction between simple world and complicated world is not very useful here. A better way to describe that difference is, instead of saying simple or complicated, we can say we have two kind of models of the world. In the first model, the world is so messy and it's complicated in a way that we cannot make decisions. The complexities of the world lead us to be indecisive and confused. We don't know what to do. And in another model of the world is still complicated, still messy, it's still confusing, but we can find ways of making decisions. So we don't have a simple versus complex dichotomy, but we have a world where decision-making is possible. We can be clear enough to make decisions versus a world where we are indecisive and confused forever. And here in this book, we are given an interpretation of the world that is a place where we can make decisions. Something else I don't like. Being older and wiser in this book is associated with having answers, having all the answers, and having certainty about life's big questions. But I don't think being wiser is about having all the answers and being more confident, being more certain. Maybe being wiser is about the ability to live in peace with the questions, to be able to live with uncertainty, to be able to live without the answers. Maybe that is about what being wise is about. I also want to read a conversation between these two characters in which both of them get emotional, not just the young man. Because if only the young man is getting emotional, if only the young man is moved by the conversation, as influenced deeply by the conversation, that means that the philosopher is not really in it. It's not really invested. It's not really being moved. The conversation is not really affecting the old philosopher. It's like two chess players are playing, but one chess player is not good enough, so he can never surprise the more experienced chess player. But it is possible that for the more experienced older chess player to see something, to see a combination, to see a move, to see a kind of play for the first time and say, oh, I had no idea. Maybe I should revise my ways of thinking. So a serious challenge is never really presented to the philosopher. Another place where I found the discussion to be a little bit too simplistic was when they covered the topic of praise and blame. The philosopher said that you should never rebuke or praise anyone, because whenever we rebuke or praise somebody, if you are talking down to them, if you're condescending to them, and anyone who praises somebody else is having a vertical relationship with them, saying that I'm able, you're not able. So both praising and rebuking are bad. I think that that's a little bit too strict. Finally, I'm almost done with my criticisms. There are certain inaccuracies in the beginning of the book. There are certain inaccuracies about the figure Alfred Adler and his relationship with Freud and the history of psychoanalysis. Adler's psychology, they say, is very unique because it is rooted in Greek philosophy. But this applies equally well, if not better, to Freud and to Jung. Freud was extensively knowledgeable in Greek mythology, in Greek philosophy. Jung also extensively knowledgeable about the history of ideas. So Adler is not unique, does not have a unique status in that way. In another place in the book, we read that Jung was younger than Freud and more like a student or mentee of Freud, but Adler was closer to Freud and more like a fellow. He was closer to Freud's age and he was more of a colleague, less of a student. This is not true. There was a difference between Jung and Adler in age. And Jung was only 5 years younger than Adler, which doesn't make them belong to separate generations. Freud was 14 years older than Adler and 19 years older than Jung. And that difference is not that substantial. Next, Alfred Adler was not the only person who disagreed with Freud. So in that way, he's also not unique. Here we get the impression that Adler was the only one who was unique and in separating his path from the rest of the psychoanalytic movement. That's simply not true. If you read Sigmund Freud's own account of the history of psychoanalysis, you will see that Freud preferred Adler to Jung. So there was a more fundamental disagreement between Jung and Freud compared to the disagreement between Adler and Freud. Finally, the philosopher Epictetus was not credited, and his ideas are present in this work in a major way. So overall, I would recommend this book if you're interested, if you're relatively new to psychology, philosophy, getting into reading books, this might be a very good place to begin. I would not strongly recommend, but I would moderately recommend reading this book. Now, further readings. If you enjoyed this book, you might also enjoy two books by Irvin Yalom. Irvin Yalom has a book called When Nietzsche Wept. It's a work of fiction, but it's a story about a relationship between two people, and that relationship is therapeutic. Helps one side become more aware of the human condition, of their own condition in life. So if you enjoy reading dialogues, thoughtful dialogues related to psychology and philosophy, you will enjoy the book When Nietzsche Wept. The other book by Yalom is The Schopenhauer Cure. In that book, there is a character similar to Ichiro Kishimi. There's a character in The Schopenhauer Cure who is totally enamored by Schopenhauer and believes that Schopenhauer, together with Stoicism, they have all the answers to the problems of human life. I would also recommend reading The Discourses of Epictetus. And if you read that, you will realize how much this book is influenced by those ideas. If you'd like to read more about this, the role of trust, that you have confidence in other people, instead of constantly being doubtful, constantly being insecure and questioning your relationship with other people, instead trusting them and making a decision to treat other people as comrades, as friends, as people who are at least potentially on your side. If you're interested in reading about that, the importance of that decision, the courage to decide, the courage to have confidence in other people, I would recommend reading the book Humankind by Rutger Bregman. I would also recommend reading the book by Freud called The History of Psychoanalysis, or The History of the Psychoanalytic Movement. In that book, you will get Freud's side of the story about how psychoanalysis developed originally, how the idea of trauma was revised by Freud himself. It was not Adler who revised the idea of trauma, actual events in a person's life. These traumas, they don't have to be real events, so they could be fantasies, things that the person has imagined in order to rationalize certain decisions. As Freud himself came to that conclusion quite early on in the development of psychoanalysis. And finally, to be critical about psychology as an approach that has all the answers to everything. To be critical of psychology as a whole, I would recommend reading the book called Admirable Evasions, How Psychology Undermines Morality by Theodore Dalrymple. I think he does a nice job in giving us an overarching critique of psychology and the risk of psychologizing all the problems in life, the problems of morality, politics, and social justice. Psychology cannot answer everything. It is not the case that if you change yourself, the world will necessarily always change. All right, if you have read the book, and if you now watch my commentary, my critique, I would love to hear from you. Let me know what you think, what you thought about the book. Let me know what you thought about my review, and I will speak with you in the next video. Thank you for your attention.